The crisis in Britain is part of the general crisis of European and world capitalism and can only be understood in that context. But I have here a survey of The Economist from 2011, 5 years ago, and this is how they portrayed Europe at the time. I don't know if you can see it, staring into the abyss, and all of the different members of the European Union are risking falling off the edge of a cliff into the abyss. That was the confidence of the bourgeois then, and it hasn't improved anything since then. But it's interesting, some of the things they say, it's also interesting to see how they invent new terms in order to hide what they're actually doing. Where they analyse austerity, the subheading is destructive creation. That's capitalism. Destructive creation. What that means basically is austerity, cutbacks, destroy some of the productive forces, and through that you create, i.e., of course, they're thinking of profit. But it's interesting the comment they make talking about Europe. It says that they need to grow. Only when they grow will they eventually be able to pay off their debts. And in order to do that, they need to improve their competitiveness. Everywhere across Europe, we see attacks on the working class. Attacks on working conditions, attacks on wages, attacks on welfare. And it's all in the name of staying in the European and world market. But it's interesting also to see the some of the conclusions they draw, which towards the end, if I can find it, citizens of uncompetitive economies are already exhausted by austerity. This is in 2011. And Germany and the other creditor nations are reluctant to run deficits. And then it says, the danger is that people will refuse to accept the unemployment and austerity being posed on them. Well, what we've seen since that was written is the events in Greece with the rise of Syriza, the conflict between Greece and the Troika. We've seen in Spain the rise of the phenomenon of a party such as Podemos, a party that comes from practically nowhere, around a few personalities, and balloons into a party of 300,000 members, winning around 20% of the vote, and now challenging to become the main left party in Spain. In France, we have the phenomenon of Mélenchon, who in the opinion polls at the moment stands at around 15%. Paris Match had an opinion poll on the 50 top French politicians. It was interesting to note that of the top 50 French politicians, 45 have suffered a decline in their popularity. That is not too difficult to work out why. One of the politicians who has increased his popularity is Mélenchon. Now, Paris Match calls him an ultra-left and says this is the highest popularity rating for an ultra-left politician. That's happening in France on the back of the struggles against the Loi Travail, which was an anti-working class labour law introduced in France. We recently had the phenomenon in the United States of Sanders. And here in Britain, we have the Corbyn phenomenon. I think this is the answer to what they said 5 years ago when they said, they refer to the danger that people would refuse to accept all this. It's starting to find a political expression, this opposition of working class people, of young people, all across Europe. And Britain, which up until recently, you could have made jokes about this sleepy Britain off the coast of Europe, where nothing much seemed to be happening, and suddenly Britain is catapulted into the centre stage of the European class struggle with the phenomenon around Corbyn. But before going on to discuss the emergence of Corbyn, it'd be useful to look at what's actually been happening in British society in the last few years. Some of you are probably too young to remember the 2008 crash. You, I mean, I don't remember the 1929 one, though, I guarantee that. I was born a little bit later. But what happened after 2008? Just to give you an idea, this is UK debt, the national debt, as a proportion of GDP. This is what's happened in the last few years. You can all see that. They've been applying austerity, cutting public spending, attacking pensions, attacking welfare, with the excuse that this is necessary to get down the debt. You see how successful they've been. And they're projecting that that debt will continue to grow. You remember how it suddenly ballooned. When the banks were on the verge of collapse, the state handed over huge amounts of money to the banks, not just in Britain, but on a global scale, with the idea that capitalism can't work without the banks, massively increasing the debt, and then they presented the bill to the working class. Suddenly they discovered that pensions were too high, welfare is too high, we have too many hospitals, too many schools, and there was a generalized, the attack had been going on for years, but there's an acceleration to this process. Compare this to just a few years ago. In 1989, believe it or not, Britain actually had a surplus on its annual balance. It had a surplus, not a budget deficit, but actually a surplus in its budget. But since then, obviously, it worsened. This year, there's an estimated £19 billion deficit on the state spending and income. And combined with all the other effects, paying the interest, etc., this year they will add another £48 billion to the debt. The total debt has reached £1.6 trillion. In euros, that's almost the same. That makes it easier for us in doing lead-offs. We don't have to use a calculator for the European comrades anymore. And that is about 85% of GDP. It works out that something like, you do all know, all of you who work and live here, you have £25,000 of that debt belongs to you, because the average per person broken down is that. By the end of this parliament, with these Tories in power, with all the cuts that they're carrying out, they expect that debt to reach £1.7 trillion. Compare this to the past in another sector, household debt. We shouldn't just look at the public debt, but household debt, particularly in a country like Britain. In 1971, household debt represented 30% of GDP. When the crisis hit in 2008-2009, that had reached almost 100% of GDP. That's the debt of families in this country. Since then, it's gone down to just under 90%. That can be explained partially by many families struggling to pay off their debt in a situation where they don't have the confidence about the future. And that also explains the sluggishness in the growth of the market when people are having to dedicate a significant part of their wages to paying off the accumulated debt of the past. Unemployment in this country, they pride themselves that unemployment is below 6%, which is about half what it is in France. The British capitalists explain that the reason why the French are in such a mess is because they did not do what the Germans and the British did to their working classes before, i.e. flexibilization of labour, casualization of labour, zero-hour contracts, etc. There's an element of truth in this, in the sense that the French bourgeoisie are terrified of the way the French workers could react. Considering the history and the traditions of the French working class, May 68, but it goes right back to the Paris Commune, they did delay, to a certain degree, the attack. And this year, they launched the attack on labour rights, which provoked, if you remember, that massive movement of the French working class, which is just a taste of what is to come in France. But coming back to Britain, yes, unemployment is low, relative to other countries, but we also have to look concretely at the fact that we have what is called the working poor in this country. We have many people who are working, but they're working in poverty conditions because they push the wages down so low. Just to give you some figures from Oxfam. According to Oxfam, 500,000 people in this country are now reliant on food parcels to survive. 2 million people in the UK are estimated to be malnourished. This is one of the richest countries in the world. It's in the top 5 or 6 countries for GDP, and yet there are 2 million people classed as being malnourished. 3 million are at risk of becoming so. So we could have 5 million malnourished in the next period. 36% of the UK population, it says here, are just one heating bill or a broken washing machine away from hardship. That's what separates them from having just enough to survive to falling into poverty. And it says 1 in 6 parents have gone without food themselves to feed the family. This is Britain. Title here from the BBC. More UK workers earning less than living wage, research shows. And the living wage is not the minimum wage. The living wage is actually higher. It says that the number of workers, of UK workers earning below the so-called living wage has risen to close to 5 million, according to the research, which is equivalent to about a fifth of employees. Don't want to give too many figures. The number of workers on the minimum wage has doubled in the past 15 years. They introduced the minimum wage and it was presented as a great victory, which in part it was. But then you keep the minimum wage so low that the bosses have no problem in pushing everybody else down towards the minimum wage. That's what's happened in the last 15 years. But according to other calculations, the number of workers on the minimum wage are expected to double again between now and 2020, in 4 years' time. So, yes, there are jobs, but there are jobs at these wages. And what the British are telling the French is, you should be doing the same if you want to stay in the market. Recently, we had the referendum in Britain, which went rather badly for Cameron. Now, it poses a big problem. We had a discussion earlier on about the need for capitalists to widen their markets, to conquer bigger and bigger markets. Well, Britain exports about 28% of its GDP. Over a quarter of everything which is produced in this country is exported. And about half of that goes to the European Union. Just to Germany alone, something like 11% of British exports go to Germany, 8% to Holland, 6% to France, and so on. And they're facing the dilemma of possibly losing access to that single market, which for them poses the problem of how you survive in the world market. Now, that's a separate discussion which we'll take up later on. But what is the program of the bourgeois in Britain to solve this problem? Well, I found the program of UKIP a couple of years ago. I think they've edited it slightly since then, because there are people like me and others who have the nasty habit of looking at their website and finding out what they really stand for. But it actually does represent the program of the bourgeois, such as, for example, scrapping statutory maternity pay. Women who get pregnant would no longer receive financing from the state during pregnancy. What a marvellous progressive measure we have here from UKIP. They would put to tender key National Health Service services. They'd increase a flat rate of tax, i.e. massively reducing the taxation level for the rich and pushing it up for the working class. If you read it, it is really the programme of the bourgeois. And that's what stands behind UKIP. Of course, it's interesting to observe how a party that stands for this then gets all these votes, and some of them working class votes. The question is, why? The reason is, there's nobody none of the mainstream parties are explaining to the working class the real cause of the crisis and what should be done about it. They give a very simplistic solution. There's not enough jobs, kick out the foreigners. There's not enough hospital beds, kick out the foreigners. Little detail, you kick out the foreigners, there wouldn't be any hospital beds. I've had the unfortunate experience recently of having to go to for a few checkups. You know, when you get to the age of 25, it tends to start. You get a few aches and pains here and there. I go into the hospital. One doctor I talk to, he's from Iraq. And we talk about the terrible bombing of Iraq. Another doctor I talk to is from Pakistan. The nurse is Nigerian or Filipino or Indian. And I'm thinking, and you want to get rid of the immigrants and think the system can work. Care workers, old people, old white, let's say Anglo-Saxon people who need care when they're old, most likely it will be a Filipino, a Nigerian, an immigrant from some other part of the world or within Europe itself. There are 3.5 million EU citizens in this country. But the solution of these people is reduce immigration, get control back of our borders, and that solves everything. And of course it solves nothing. But the reason why a section at least of working class people did vote for UKIP is because they are suffering. They are at the bottom of the ladder. They haven't got jobs. Services are being destroyed. And they're looking for somebody who offers some kind of radical anti-establishment position. And Farage comes along with his pint and his fags. The European comrades, you know what fags are? Somebody translate. It's slang for cigarette. And Farage likes to lean on a bar with a pint in his hand and a fag in his other hand, trying to pretend he's somehow the friend of the working class, when he's actually a stockbroker. But this shows you how a section of the bourgeois can use racism, anti-immigration rhetoric and propaganda to divide the working class and try and win a section of the workers to their policy. This, of course, will not last forever. Because you see, UKIP has actually achieved what it was set up to achieve. The independence, so-called, of the UK, breaking with the European Union. I've heard many, in other talks I've given, what's going to happen with UKIP? All these people who vote UKIP, how do you explain it? Well, the question is this. Once Britain is fully out of the European Union, which is to happen in the next couple of years, unemployment is not going to go down. In fact, if you consider the world scenario, irrespective of whether they're in or out of the European Union, unemployment is destined to grow. If you look at the programme that they're applying, the programme is one of a destruction of the NHS, whether they're in the European Union or out. It's a necessity of capitalism to cut their costs. And within a certain period of time, we're going to have an independent UK, which will actually be worse off than before. In that, you'll soon see some people blaming Brexit for the crisis, which it won't be. It can exacerbate it, but it's not the cause. The real cause is the general crisis of capitalism on a global scale. UKIP in Britain is a phenomenon which is not exclusive to Britain. Worse than UKIP, in Greece you have the Golden Dawn, open Nazis, not growing significantly, but still a presence on the right. In Italy you have the Northern League. The Northern League, it's a funny party. It was called the Northern League because it was against the Southerners, you see, and against Rome. Rome that consumes everything in Italy. If the North could only separate from the rest. And now they've suddenly discovered that it's better to change tack because it's difficult to win the votes of Southern Italians with that kind of programme. So they've turned more into a kind of right-wing racist organisation, looking for very fascist allies even within the rest of Italy. That phenomenon is there. In France we have Le Pen on the right and Mélenchon, of course, on the left. And in Britain, UKIP is the equivalent. It's part of an international phenomenon, which is the traditional parties that govern the countries are collapsing, losing support. It's happening in France. The Socialist Party is facing a huge collapse electorally. In Italy, a lot of the traditional parties went a long time ago. The instability and the fragmentation of the political scene there is a result of the crisis of the system. In Spain, we have the PSOE risks splintering, breaking up, and more votes could pass over to Podemos. So what we have across Europe is a polarization to the left and to the right. You get some people who go, oh, all these people voting for these racist parties. Throughout history, when there's a crisis of the capitalist system, you see this polarization to the left and to the right. The Nazis came to power in 1933, but the biggest communist party outside of the Soviet Union was the German Communist Party, with almost 500,000 members and 4 million votes. The Social Democracy also had millions of votes. It's the same in all these countries. Before right-wing reaction comes to power, there's always a movement of the working class which attempts to change society. It's the failure of that attempt which prepares the ground for the right wing. So forces like UKIP or Le Pen could become major forces only on the basis of intense class struggle and the failure of the working class to change society and to take power. Because going back to UKIP, the reason they get the votes, the Labour leaders are not explaining the real reason for the crisis. They're trying to find a solution within this system, and that means they can't give the answers that are required. The answer to solving the problems of the NHS are not attack the immigrants. Increase the spending on the national health. That's the solution. They say there's not enough money. They complain. You know, they complain that we're living too long. How many times have you heard that? You know, I thought, when I was growing up, that if you increase the average life expectancy, everybody would be happy. You know, we're getting older and living longer. We can enjoy life for more. Now we're told it's a problem that you're living too long. Why? Well, you see, you get your pension at 60 or 65, and you might be taking it for the next 20, 25 years. Why, God forbid. Let's kill off the workers early. It's one way of doing it. Or increase the age of retirement, which is what they're doing. So what is positive is presented as negative under capitalism. But they say, they use that as an excuse. The number of people who are on a pension proportionate to the number of people working has grown. But they ignore one little detail. The productivity of labour has grown to the nth degree in the last 50 years. Fewer workers can actually produce far more wealth than in the past. So it's a false argument to say we have too many old people, too many sick people, all the rest of it. The fact is, the wealth is concentrated in the hands of the few. And if you look at the process over the last 30 years, the concentration of wealth, you know, they talk about the 1% and the 99%. But when you actually read them closer, they say, well, actually, we should be looking at the 0.1%. Because there's a huge difference in wealth, even between them and the 1%. Never mind the rest of us. And in the last 30 years, the concentration of wealth at one end and the growth of poverty at the other end has massively increased. And that's a consequence, obviously, of the way capitalism functions. This monopolization and concentration are essential aspects of capitalism. And in crisis, this is enhanced even further. Now, what's concerning the bourgeois is, you see, they're trying to achieve some kind of stability within the system. But there are different types of stability. There's political stability. There's social stability. Now, in order to... and economic stability, obviously. In order to rebalance the economy and get it functioning from their point of view, what the policies that they're required to adopt are actually provoking social and political instability. Because as they try... To balance the books, let's say, more and more people are falling off the edge at one end and drawing conclusions, political conclusions, and looking for alternatives. Therefore, they must be quite worried about the fact that the other Europeans in the negotiations over Brexit are coming out with the idea that they are going to be hard in the negotiations. The ideal, of course, would be that they get access to the single market and they make a compromise over immigration. But that's going to be very difficult because, you see, if the Europeans, and by Europeans I don't mean the comrades sitting here, I mean the capitalists from these countries, the Europeans, if they make any serious concession to Britain in these negotiations, will be opening the door to more and more countries across Europe posing the question, let's have a referendum too, because there's a widespread anti-European Union move developing across Europe. It exists in France, it exists in Italy. How many people in Italy now says, bring back the lira, you know? There's this mood that exists, and if they make any concessions, it could be the beginning of the fragmentation of the European Union, the breakup of the European Union, the breakup of the single market, which would be disastrous from the point of view of the interests of international capital, because they need to widen their markets, not narrow them. So that's the dilemma facing them. But look at what it's doing to the Tory party. The Tory party, in reality, is split right down the middle. Theresa May, you see this, the switch that she's done. She was for Remain, and now she's a hard-line, hard Brexiteer. And how do you explain that? Well, it's the Tory party itself. It's the ranks of the Tory party, and even a section of the electorate. They're trying, one, to keep people voting Tory instead of going over to UKIP. They have that problem. And two, trying to hold the party together, which is in fact divided. There's a little item here from June, and it said that this was on the 28th of June. It said, yesterday around 40 Tory MPs who backed the Remain side in the referendum held a secret meeting. I love these secret meetings. So secret it gets into the Evening Standard. A secret meeting in Westminster Hall where at least a dozen were described as virulently anti-Boris. And by the way, talk about the decline of Britain. I think the figure of the foreign minister of this country embodies and epitomises the whole of the decline of Britain. When I was in France a couple of weeks ago, I don't know if I've got it here somewhere, I read that Boris at the party conference actually said the building of the foreign ministry from this office, we governed an empire seven times the size of the Roman Empire. He said that at the party conference. I read that and I thought, he's crazy. Does he really think they're going to rebuild that? One. Two, imagine being the son of an Indian or a Pakistani or a West Indian, second, third generation in this country, and the foreign minister of your government is boasting about the empire that they used to have, ignoring everything they did to the colonial peoples. But it shows you what a joke it's become. Even more funny is when you see him talking about Syria, if it wasn't so tragic. But there is a split in the Conservative Party, and it's a consequence of this crisis. Theresa May is attempting to hold the party together, but they cannot stop that process from unravelling at a later stage. I have to quote this one. It's from the Washington Post. You know, when she spoke at the party Conservative Party conference, Theresa May boasted about Britain being the fifth largest economy in terms of GDP. And it says the headline says, after her speech, it dropped to sixth. Because in that short period of time, the devaluation of the pound meant that the value of British GDP relative to others had slipped to sixth position. That's some impact on the process. Now, coming closer to home, in the sense of the working class of this country, what we've seen in the last 2 years has been a sudden leap in the process. We're talking, when we do discussions about Marxism and dialectical materialism, and we talk about things turning into their opposites and quantity and quality and all that stuff, I'm sure that somebody outside listening would probably think, what the hell are they talking about? But here we have an example of a sudden leap in the consciousness in Britain, a sudden change in the political situation, which is not that sudden. It's not a surprise for us Marxists. It is the product of everything I've described here. there is a huge layer of the population which is suffering, really suffering, and another section which is just holding on. They got jobs, they got the money, but life is tougher than it used to be. And yet, if you looked at some figures, for example, the strike figures for 2015 in Britain, if you applied a mechanical, rigid approach, well, you'd say 81,000 workers were involved in strike action in 2015. That is the smallest number since record began in 1893. Now, if you read this, you could say, well, everything's fantastic in Britain, isn't it? Workers are not going on strike. They must be so happy. But the truth is somewhat different. As Marxists, we don't just look at this. There are some reasons that you can explain this. Italy also has a very low number of strikes. And the reason is, with the crisis in the economy, particularly in industry, where jobs are at risk, it's not easy to suddenly just get up and go on strike and basically put yourself forward as a candidate for the next worker to get sacked. There is that terror in the factories, in the workplaces. That explains partially this, but this is not enough to understand what's going on. Lenin used to study in detail strike figures to understand what's happening, but it's not enough. You have to look at some other aspects as well. You can actually have a political radicalization to the left and not much going on the trade union front. The two things can happen. Of course, we have another phenomenon. Apparently, I found this was interesting. Although fewer strikes, more strikes lasting more than one day, which means that where workers have been pushed to the limit to come out, the disputes are more bitter, are stronger. The workers are more determined. I think that's an indication of what will happen in the future when the working class starts to move. But beyond that, what we see around Corbyn is a huge phenomenon. 81,000 workers participating in a strike, and 500,000 join the Labour Party. They're not going on strike, but they're doing something else. They're looking for a political tool, a party, an instrument with which to challenge the austerity. What I said right at the beginning from The Economist, you know, that at some point people will get fed up and will start to resist. This Corbyn phenomenon is the same as Podemos, it's the same as Syriza before it. It's an attempt of working class people to forge a party which they need. But let's look at the Labour Party. Again, there we see a sudden change, in effect, almost changing into its opposite, the same party. Up until 2 years ago, this party was dominated by the Blairites. In the Parliamentary Labour Party, it is still dominated by the Blairites. In the bureaucracy, it is still dominated by the Blairites. But 2 years ago, they also dominated right at the bottom. If you went to a local Labour Party meeting in a lot of areas, very small numbers of people coming along. And it would sometimes, I've been to meetings where, you know, almost half the people there were councillors. There was very little life in the Labour Party at that stage. But you had Blair dominating for years. You had the attempt to break the link between the Labour Party and the trade unions. They successfully changed some of the Constitution. Clause 4, Part 4 was removed from the Constitution, which about public property. And it was moving in a certain direction. Then what happens? 2010 elections. Labour Party loses the elections. Ed Miliband, if you remember, do you remember Red Ed? It wasn't to do with his hair. It was to do with his apparent standing to the left of his brother, David, my other Bolshevik in the Labour Party. Now, Ed Miliband, what did he do? If you're in it, some of you will remember, he tacked very, very slightly to the left. Do you remember? And he won some of the trade union votes, and he clinched the party leadership by 50 point something, defeating his brother. After that, there was a thinking in the Labour Party bureaucracy and the tops that we're not going to allow the trade unions to decide the next leader of the Labour Party. That was part of the thinking. Ed Miliband collaborated in changing the rules. And if we look back, when they changed the rules which meant one man, one vote, one woman, one vote, whatever, one person, one vote. It looked like, and it was, a reactionary step, in the sense that it was an attempt to remove the power of the trade unions from inside the Labour Party, take away their big bloc votes. And they thought they were being very clever. And what was behind the thinking of the rule change, which said not just one person, one vote, but £3 and a click, and you vote for the leader. And you can join the Labour Party as a supporter and vote for the leader. What was the thinking? The thinking was this. The masses are always more moderate than the activists. And I'm thinking, Jesus Christ, how more moderate could you be than some of the people I have spoken to in the Labour Party at the back at that time? That's the theory, however. They thought this: if we widen out the electoral base to the public, the more moderate public will come in and they will drown any of these potential lefties in the ranks of the party. It's actually the other way around. What happened was they opened the doors to the party, of the party to a mass of people, but even that by itself wouldn't have been enough. Because I'm telling you, if last year, in 2015, when they had the first vote for party leader, if Corbyn had not been a candidate, you would not have had 500,000 people joining to vote. Who do you vote? The other three candidates, there's not a cigarette paper between them to distinguish them. They're all the same. They all have the same thinking. It wouldn't have happened, even if they'd had that phenomenon. What happened was the combination of two things, which the Blairites to this day have not really understood, is the possibility of people to come in and vote, and two, a candidate who stands against austerity, which shows the huge potential which already existed within British society for a political movement, an opposition to austerity. It just needed a point of reference, which wasn't there. Corbyn provided it. Again, another mistake the Blairites made. I remember when Corbyn was at he had 17 MPs nominating him. And if you read how it went, when the leadership race came up, in his office with other people, shall we put John McDonald or Schiller? In the end, Corbyn says, oh, I'll do it, go on, I'll do it. And they thought, raise the flag, you know, just to show we're still here. None of them thought what was going to happen would happen. But the combination of these factors, you go on TV, the first time they go on TV, the four candidates, and the process starts. Once Corbyn was there with his anti-austerity measures, message, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands started to come in to the Labour Party because they saw in him a politician worth supporting. And you see what happened subsequently. Tony Blair has twice written articles saying, I don't understand why this is happening. And I read it and I thought, I know you don't understand, but you don't need to say it. You know, if you're stupid, don't go around saying that you are stupid. Just shut up. You know the saying is, it's better to shut up and let people think you're stupid than to talk and let them see that you actually are. But they couldn't understand it. Why? Because they're completely out of touch with what's really happening in British society. They don't understand what's happening in working class neighbourhoods, what's happening to people whose benefits have been taken away from them. Just the other day, the news was that Concentrix, it's an American company, which was brought in to check on tax credit claims. And the idea was a private company will be more efficient at cutting the amount of the benefits we pay. And they were taking benefit off a lot of people who actually had a right to it. And such was the complaint. Even this government has had to take the contract away from Concentrix and bring it back in-house into the and get government workers to do the job. But these attacks on the poorest layers, they're attacking the layers that least can tolerate this crisis and these attacks. And there's a seething anger developing from below. During the referendum campaign, I saw on TV a woman, I think from the north of this country somewhere. She had a northern accent, anyway. Don't know if it was Yorkshire or Lancashire, but anyway. They said to her, but if we leave the European Union, it'll get worse. And she said, what? Worse than what we already have. Worse than this. And there is a part of British society which people like Tony Blair, they live on another planet, to be honest. And that's why they made that big mistake. Now, we have this completely new phenomenon, which is the Labour Party, from being a party of 180,000 members, they used to say tripled. It's actually practically almost quadrupled its membership. It's 650,000 members. I think one of the biggest, if not the biggest, left party in Europe, in absolute terms, in numbers. And it's made up of a membership which is young people, workers, working people, who want change. They want an end to the austerity. And you see the viciousness of the bourgeois attacking Corbyn. They attack him by saying he's unelectable. I always thought, well, if he's unelectable, why are you so concerned? Just leave him alone. You know, if he's such an idiot, if he's such a crazy left that can never win votes, well, just carry on. In fact, there was one. There's one article which really made me laugh in The Economist from September, talking about Corbyn having taken over, and they say the Conservative government can expect years without being seriously challenged in Westminster. I.e., with Corbyn at the head of the Labour Party, how can they ever win an election? The more serious bourgeois, however, realise that, you see, they know what they've got to do. Working class people know what's happened, they've got an inkling of what's coming. But the serious bourgeois at the top, they know the programme they have to apply. I quoted part of it, it was in the UKIP programme. It's a brutal attack on the working class. Privatise the National Health Service, attacking education at all levels, and a decline in living standards, which will be massive. They know that's coming. The clever bourgeois also know that if the Tories do that for the next 3-4 years, they will pay at the next election. And the only alternative is the Labour Party. And that's the problem they've got. This party, which for 100 years they have used, when the Tories lose, Labour comes in. Labour loses, swing back to the Tories. The system was based on the two parties, with very little difference between the two in terms of policy, except maybe during the economic boom, when capitalism could afford the NHS and other reforms. But in the recent period, you can hardly tell the difference between the policies of the Blairite leaders of the Labour Party and the Tories. To have a Labour Party in a position where it could win an election on the basis of brutal attacks by the Tories, led by Corbyn, is of huge concern for the bourgeois of this country. And they have been doing everything. You see all the dirty tricks that they've pulled out. The barrage of attacks. For instance, anti-Semitism. Anti-Semitism in the Labour Party. You know, you talk to any Labour Party member and you say, anti-Semitism? Where? Where is the anti-Semitism? You know what it is? If anybody in the Labour Party dares to say that we support the Palestinians against what the Israelis are doing, that's anti-Semitism. Because you're against Jews, you see. They've constructed this myth, and they're spreading it, the Sun and other newspapers, a vicious attack, making out that he's unelectable, he can't run do his job, all kinds of stuff is being pulled out. The reason is they want to get rid of him. And they weren't happy with once. They had a second election. And let's see what happened. What did they achieve by having the second challenge to Corbyn? He increased his majority in percentage terms, massively increased the number of people voting for him, over 300,000. By the way, he was able to joke in Parliament with Theresa May when she congratulated him. And he said, yeah, I am rather proud of the fact that over 300,000 people voted for me, which is something you can't say, Madam May, you know, whatever they call each other, the Right Honourable Theresa May. That's the truth of the situation. There is this surge from the left around Corbyn. Now, what are they going to do? Because they have one hell of a problem on their hands. They tried to get rid of him. They made him stronger. They've increased his votes. They've increased his majority. But it's still the same MPs as before who are sitting around him. And they are already, immediately after the victory of Corbyn, they're plotting again. All kinds of proposals, you know, the Parliamentary Labour Party should elect the cabinet. That means, you know, the 90% of right-wing MPs should elect the cabinet that's got to be led by Corbyn, elected by over 300,000 working people. The two things cannot come together. There was talk at one point of an open split. That split is there, but you can see that the bourgeois, their tactics at this particular moment are wear Corbyn down, don't split away, because if they were to split away, let's look at this possible scenario. The majority of Labour MPs split and form some kind of Democratic Labour Party or whatever. Probably would enter a coalition of some kind with other parties to govern. That would be a classic national government scenario. The Labour Party in the very short term in that situation would be reduced to a rump in Parliament. But having broken from the Labour Party, give that kind of government 2, 3, 4, 5 years of government with the draconian policies they've got to apply, at the next round, you'd have Labour MPs nominated from below, far to the left of the ones we have at the moment, and you'd have the prospect of a left Labour government coming to power in this country. The bourgeois are looking at that possibility, and they're terrified of it, because of the power of the British working class that would be unleashed behind such a government. Here comes the question of leadership. What should be done in the Labour Party today? Well, it's obvious. You can elect Corbyn as leader, but the deputy leader needs to be changed too, doesn't he? Yes. Watson, yeah. Comrade Watson, you know, who speaks in Labour Party, capitalism isn't the problem, you know, business and that. And all those others who are really, a lot of them are just Tories in disguise. They could easily move over to the Tory party or the Liberal party. The Liberal party is not so good because it doesn't offer as many careers. That's the problem, you see. This is a process of radicalisation of the working class and the youth, expressing itself politically, and the first stage is this Corbyn phenomenon. But what would a Corbyn government do? You know, at the moment, all the ranks are uniting in the Labour Party to support Corbyn, and we support Corbyn. We're in the Labour Party, or at least those comrades who haven't been expelled for saying, you know, Blairite traitor 10 years ago on Twitter. Did it exist 10 years ago, Twitter? Thousands of people have been expelled or suspended for the slightest excuse. Because they were desperately trying to reduce the left, and they failed to do so. But there is a problem. Corbyn is the leader, but he leads a Labour Party which is dominated by right-wing Blairites. Therefore, the next task, surely, is a battle in every constituency, from the bottom upwards, to change the MPs. If you want a left Labour government, you can't have it with these Labour MPs. You know what the problem is? The dilemma that Corbyn is facing is if he announced that, which is what he should do, there would be a split in the Labour Party the next day. The MPs, all those MPs who have made a nice career out of politics, voting austerity and all the rest of it, if they smelt the threat of reselection, they would split, because they would know the next election they're going to remove us anyway. So they would split and try and destroy the Labour Party from outside with the support of Murdoch and all the other media, a barrage of propaganda against the Labour Party. So Corbyn is really trying to square the circle. They do all this to him, and what does he do? Come back. Come back, all is forgiven. It's like the prodigal son, you know, coming back. They come back with daggers behind him. And in one article, I haven't got it here, I can't find it. The Financial Times actually, when it said, I think it's here. Here it is. Here's the language of the democratic bourgeoisie, British bourgeoisie. Whatever happens over the next few days, a challenge should be mounted. This is this was back in I can't find it now, earlier this year. Having unsheathed the dagger, Labour MPs cannot now draw back. The dagger. That's what they're talking about. There was one MP. Do you remember that woman, MP? When they accused the Blairites of stabbing him in the back. She said, I wouldn't stab Corbyn in the back. I'd stab him in the front. And doesn't get suspended. Doesn't get expelled. for such a comment, and yet anybody who just says, boo, I don't like you, you're out of the Labour Party. If you're on the left. If you're on the right, you can say whatever you like. Now, the problem is this. Corbyn cannot carry out even the policies that he stands for with this parliamentary Labour group. It's so obvious. It's obvious to anybody. He cannot do that. And he will therefore be forced to compromise if he wants to hold them together. And the bourgeois are not stupid. They understand that. During the Labour Party conference, John McDonnell gave an interview to the BBC. And he explained that his vision of a Labour government would be an interventionist Labour government, collaborating with the private sector to create wealth for everybody. You know, we would borrow, it's the same line, we'd borrow money and use it to stimulate the economy. Well, that is not good enough if we're going to change society and if we're going to even to end austerity in Britain today. What is required is a Labour government with left Labour MPs, elected by the rank and file, MPs who are not there for a career, but who are there to represent working class people, and who will carry out policies in the interests of working class people. And it's not even enough to have that. You've got to have a fully worked out programme with this level of debt, with this crisis that we have and the situation we're facing. If you want to keep the NHS, if you want to keep free education, and if you want to start improving the lives of ordinary working class people, you've got to nationalise the major companies of this country and the major banks. The big ones, take them over and run them in a planned manner. That's what a left Labour government would have to do. And if you don't do that, if you want to know what the alternative is, just look at the other end of Europe and look at Greece. If you want to know what happens if you don't apply a socialist programme, look at Greece. The Troika forced the Greek government, with all its promises, free electricity for 300,000 families. Do you remember all those all that programme before the elections, which made him very popular? Tsipras was riding high in February last year to 80% popularity rating. Do you know how many votes Syriza will get at the next election, according to the latest opinion polls? 17%. That's half of what they got in the last election. And the party that would win would be the New Democracy. This kind of reformism, by not challenging capitalism when it's in government, is forced to buckle under and apply the policies that the capitalists want. And in response, you have a fall in popularity and the right wing is strengthened. That is the danger of the future. That's why the battle to win the Labour Party to a genuine socialist programme is at the centre of the class struggle of this country. And that's what any decent socialist, any worker, any youth that really wants to change the society, they should be there battling against the Blairites to make sure that we get the left Labour government we want with the programme that's necessary. Otherwise, the alternative is unimaginable.